working power in the precious blood of I'm last. Would you do service for Jesus, your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily his praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Amen. I'm so glad you're back here this evening. What a wonderful service we had this morning. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you. Thank you for the service this evening. Lord, I ask you to be with the singing, be with the preaching, be with the preacher, that you give us power, your power from on high. Lord, we surely love you. Thank you for the visitors this morning and the spirit this morning and the message this morning. You sure did meet with us. We thank you for that in your son's name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
All right, number 387. Ooh. Time out. I don't know it. I'm the substitute. So let's take a favorite. I'm just being honest. Yes, Brother Sampson? 386. I'm sorry, I didn't hear that. But, all right. Turn back one. 386.
Lord, I give my life to you. Take control each day. I will follow anywhere, near or far away. Here am I, Lord, send me. Here am I, Lord, send me. I will serve you faithfully. Here am I, Lord, send me. Lord, I want your perfect will. Be my faithful guide. I will never be afraid. You are close beside. Here am I, Lord, send me. Here am I, Lord, send me. I will serve you faithfully. Here am I, Lord, send me. On the last. Let me see my mission field all around each day. Fill my heart with Jesus' love. Use me, Lord, I pray. Here am I, Lord, send me. Here am I, Lord, send me. I will serve you faithfully. Here am I, Lord, send me.
Amen. What a wonderful song. And Lord willing, we embody those words. And that we will go wherever the Lord wants. If you are a visitor tonight, and for the visitor, first time or the first time in a long time, our junior ushers in the back, they have visitor cards. And if they did not give you one already, they would love to give you one. We will not embarrass you, but if you raise your hand so we can get you a visitor card so you can receive a gift out in the back in the lobby after the service on my right, your left, and we'd love to do that. Did we miss anybody? We're so glad you're here this evening. Thank you, ushers. I appreciate that. And I'm so glad you're here. Looking forward to the Lord has. Let me give you just a little update about the Show Me Gospel Project. It has been exciting to be a part of. And if you've not been a part of it, you are shorting yourself. And yes. You are robbing yourself of a blessing. And for those that show up, they are being blessed. And just to be able to do the great commission of the Lord. We passed out 1,846 yesterday, and which brings our total up to 10,864. So praise the Lord for that. What I love about it is, out of those 10,800 John Romans that have been passed out, we together as a church assembled them. and we got to pray over them and assemble them, and then now we are handing them out. And they've been touched several times, whether that be through assembling them or the willing workers put them in bags and us going out and putting them in the doors. And I'm excited to see what the Lord will do as we encourage Christians. Sometimes it's just encourage a Christian that gets a John Romans, like, oh, thank you so much. And maybe that'll be enough to get them back in church, and or maybe someone needs to be saved. And so we praise the Lord for that. Make sure you come out for that. Obviously be a prayer partner. We have to have the prayer partners, because the goal is not just Jefferson City. It's not just Cole County. It's to the state and to the regions beyond and whatever the Lord would have in that. But we need a prayer partner, and also physically be a part of that. On Saturday mornings at 9:30, we'll have breakfast again this Saturday. We'll meet together and have about a meeting about 9:55, and then we'll go out and hit the streets. It's been fantastic. The Lord has held the weather off, and what a blessing that is. And well, we're so glad you're here, and I think...
I'd like to add to that too. I've got four kids between 18 months and 7 years old, and we do the Show Me Gospel Project, and it's so nice to have something you know your family can serve in, and my kids love it. And if you're kind of new to the church, you don't have a ministry, you don't have anywhere you're serving, it's great. It's a great way, number one, to fellowship and get to meet people in the mornings that you're attending church with. And number two, when you don't know what to say, it's like, Brother Josh, I can't witness. I don't know what to say. We'll take a first step and just hand out God's word. He can do the rest. Be a part of that if you can. Number 397, stand please. I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land. A higher plane that I have found, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Have a small town of fellowship. On the second, my heart has no desire to stay where doubts arise and fears dismay. Though some may dwell where these abound, my prayer, my aim is higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land. A higher plane than I have found, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to live above the world, though Satan's darts at me are hurled. For faith has caught the joyful sound,
the song of saints on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher, and on the last, I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright, but still I'll pray till heaven I found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Amen.
Thessalonians 5 this evening. I'll let you stay seated. And my daughter was signing to me from the front there, saying, "Man, Josh Lato's a savage wearing that polo shirt 24 hours, what Alabama did at Mizzou." But I found out, I got good news for everybody. That isn't actually an Arkansas polo shirt. He bought it by accident, thinking it was Alabama, but it's an Arkansas Razorbacks polo shirt. So I say that to Alabama fans all the time. Is that Alabama or Arkansas? Because they both are red and white, and they both have a big A on there, so... That's pretty savage, man, wearing that shirt 24 hours after. Some of you have no idea what I'm talking about. I just want to proud, if my mother-in-law watches this message tonight, I'm proud that my mother-in-law does not know who The Rock is. She texted me this afternoon after watching the service, said, "Randy, I don't know who The Rock is, and I even Googled him, and I still don't know who he is." So, well, that's good. There's a few of you out there that don't know who he is, amen. Don't learn about it, Mom, but anyway, that was great. So, 1 Thessalonians 5 this evening, I wasn't planning on saying this, but... my wife actually came up with the idea as a ministry where every few months we have a meal after church on Sunday morning, and newer folk, and if you're newer here, you'll probably be contacted for the next time around. But we had a meal this afternoon with some families and allowed them to ask questions about our church and just get to know each other. And Miss Nikki did a phenomenal job, event coordinator, planning that. Brother Bussey and his family were there to help, and I just appreciate it so much. I had a great time with some families this afternoon, and so we appreciate that. And just thankful for all the good things God's doing here, and praise the Lord for that. Look at 1 Thessalonians 5 with me. 5. How many have daughters? All right, how many have daughters? All right, how many have more than one daughter? All right, good. All right, I got 3, you know that, and one son. And I think this opening illustration will relate to those more so. But look at verse 1. But of the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I write unto you. For yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. For when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. But, I love this, ye brethren are not in darkness that day should overtake you as a thief. Ye are all the children of light and of the children of day. We are not of the night nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch. Let us what? And be sober, for they that sleep, sleep in the night, and they that be drunken are drunken in the night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and for an helmet, the hope of salvation. I want to speak briefly on the night on the subject of have you noticed? Have you noticed? Thank you.
Prison cells to desert places, broken homes and hopeless cases. From every prayer on desperate knees, time and time again you'll see what it can do. Oh, any time that you say the name, the only name that's ever calmed the waves. Say the name, the only name that has the power to save. Say the name, the only name by which the dead are raised. Oh, say the name, just say the name of Jesus. From worried looks on doctors' faces, empty cribs and faith that's shaken, when there's just no other words to speak, time and time again you'll see what it can do. Oh, any time that you say the name, the only name that's ever calmed the waves. Say the name, the only name that has the power to save. Say the name, the only name by which the dead are raised. Oh, say the name, just say the name of Jesus. It's hope and healing for the broken. It's strength and courage for the weak. It's life and freedom for the captive. There is no greater name that we could ever speak. Say the name, the only name that's ever calmed the waves. Say the name, the only name that has the power to save. Say the name, the only name by which the dead are raised. Oh, say the name, just say the name, just say the name, say the name of Jesus. Just say Jesus.
I love how the Lord works things out right before he knows I'm preaching this message. He brings in some weather that we haven't had for a little while. The weather's been so nice the last few weeks in Missouri, except for the nice Oregon smoke that gave us the haze last week, I guess they were saying. But you look out the window right now, and you can tell something's coming soon. And I guess according to the phone, my phone, which is it's not always accurate, we know that, it says that we have a 70% chance of rain at 5 p.m. And then by 7 o'clock tonight, it's 100% chance of rain. And so I think your teen activity changed a little bit. So weather can dictate that. And nothing wrong with playing out there in the rain, right? I mean, the teens would love that, right, guys? Yeah, all right. But the point of the message, this going back to the daughters thing, is I grew up in a home with deaf parents, and I think to be honest with you, the deaf culture is probably not as, it's funny, they're so sensitive to their eyes, but they're probably not as observant of new decorations or new haircuts like the hearing culture is. Our family can redecorate our house, and my family won't notice for 6 months, say, oh, wow, you painted this room. It's like, yeah. Yeah, my sister's like, oh, no, you don't. You don't. The Dignans don't. Then don't argue me in church. I got the pulpit right now, all right? See, somebody needs to control that sister. Hey, Jorge, control your wife. Control your wife in church, all right? He's got the baby. But when you grow up with three daughters, especially having two daughters first, you learn early on to observe things. Painted fingernails, painted toenails, you know, the new princess pillow, the new hairstyles, the new dress they can twirl around, and it's amazing how much my girls have grown up. I don't necessarily see the twirly dress thing anymore. I mean, Brielle did it the other day. It was a little awkward. But anyway, but you see, you learn to observe things. And I've been so thankful that God gave me. I'm glad I have one son, but I'm thankful for the girls. God gave me girls, and they've taught me a lot, all right? And then I get in at 2 a.m. the other night from Kentucky, and I walk to my front door, and I look at the door, and it's like, I know what Janelle did tonight while I was gone. She did that once four times a year where she changes out her decorations in her house. How many do that, right? It's fall now, so you got to change out the decorations. I mean, Stephanie does a good job of changing this. I try to observe it, and I text her sometimes to thank you. And you know, there's so many things you have to notice. Now, how many of you men have been guilty of not noticing something and then feeling bad about it, right? Or maybe you probably didn't feel bad about it until your wife reminded you you're supposed to feel bad about it. Can I get an amen right there? All right, many men are raising their hands there, right? I don't get offended. I get a haircut sometimes, and my family won't even notice for 3 days. Oh, Daddy, you got a haircut? Yeah, who cares, right? But the point I'm trying to make is this. I have learned to be observant of those things. If my wife gets a new shirt, I want to notice it, and I work on that. It helps a lot that it shows up on the front door on Amazon. You open up, look in it, and then you act, oh, babe, is that a new shirt? But anyway, so there's lots of tricks to the trade. But I've learned to be more observant, and I tell you, I think one of the things that I think as we get close to the end, and let's be honest, we all understand, nobody's going to, in this pulpit at least, announce when the rapture is going to happen. That's not going to happen. I mean, the Bible's clear on that, but the Bible does say here in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 that we should not be ignorant of the times and the seasons. I mean, look at verse 1. It says, but of the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I write unto you. Paul saying, there is a coming day where you can just look outside the window and say, you know what? It's going to rain. Now, it has not rained yet, but it's going to rain. Now, the phone predicts it exactly. I don't trust that thing. You know what I trust? When I go outside and feel the raindrops hitting my face. That I know is it's raining, right? And so tonight I want to encourage you to think about an important truth as we approach this. I say, to not ignore God's decorations. God is slowly changing some of the things we're supposed to look at as Christians, and it can be very dangerous as Christians to overlook them and be distracted by things in life that we're not noticing that God has changed the decorations out. And a lot of times it's not necessarily God himself directly changing the decorations, but it's happening, things that are happening around, but God, of course, is allowing it to happen. And God is going to give us as Christians the ability and the insight to figure these things out. The children of Issachar had an understanding of the times in the Old Testament. In the Chronicles, it says that. And we as Christians today really need to stay alert, watch, and be sober. And look at verse number 6 there. Verse number 6, it says, therefore, let us not sleep. Here's what it says. As do what? Others. If Paul is telling us not to sleep, then that means we have the potential to sleep. I'm not talking about physical sleep. We're talking about spiritual sleep. And I believe the devil has a tool bag full of his arsenal to try to destroy or to keep the church down. I sat in the back and listened to Brother John this morning teach on the book of Joel. Great message. As I was sitting there listening to it, I thought it was interesting. God knew I was preaching this. And Joel has a lot of interesting things mentioned in there, as Brother John brought to light this morning. And then, of course, Peter himself in Acts chapter 2, when he has the chance to preach the gospel to all those people and 3,000 souls get saved, he quotes from the book of Joel. And in that quoting of the book of Joel, Peter's even saying, hey, y'all better pay attention. We're getting close. And Paul, we're getting close. But now in 2020, there is no debate how close we are. I mean, Peter and Paul could have lived with that urgency. He said it's going to happen any time. But there was still so much prophecy unfulfilled yet. I mean, look at Israel, right? Back then, Israel, the state of them. But we are living in days where, listen, the next event on God's calendar, biblically speaking tonight, is the rapture of the church. Now, when is it going to happen? I know there's a whole lot of debate. Some people are pre-trib, some are mid-trib. The church knows where we stand on that. But I will say this. I don't think it's going to be as easy as many of us think it is. We're already singing in America. And for those of us that don't know here in America how comfortable we've become, persecution is happening globally to the church more than ever, they say. Yeah. There's a lot of things changing. And the Christian better be astute and ready to notice the changes in hairstyles. Notice that the fingernails just got recently done. Notice that the hanger on the door has gone from summer to fall. Because we're getting close, church. We're getting close. So what's the danger tonight? Well, the danger is this. We could be guilty of what Peter, James, and John were like in Matthew chapter 26. Matthew chapter 26. When Jesus took them aside, prayer time, the Bible says he went a little further to pray. And when he came back, he found them, what? Asleep. He wakes them up, or tries to, goes away a second time to pray, comes back and finds them, what? In fact, if you read the verse there, it says the exact two words, asleep. Again. Ha, there's our word for our theme for the year. If God's going to want us to do things again and again and again, guess what? The devil's going to want us to do things also again and again and again. And they're going to conflict each other. If God wants us to be spiritually awake, the devil's going to say, hey, take a nap again and again and again. Take another nap again and again. And sleep spiritually through, watch this now, the most exciting days in the history of mankind. So he comes back a third time, and he actually says this. You can read it later, Matthew chapter 26. He says, sleep on now. And then somebody shows up. Anybody know who shows up? Judas. And I often ask this question as I travel and preach. Who woke up the disciples in the garden that night? It was Judas. It wasn't Jesus. Jesus tried to wake him up, but they didn't. All right, real quickly, before I give you a few points, I'll be done. Look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 real quickly. 2 Thessalonians. For some reason, the theme of the Thessalonians is the rapture in the end. You'll see that. Not all of it, but 1 and 2 Thessalonians. For some reason, God led the Apostle Paul by the Holy Spirit of God to write on that theme quite a bit. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse number 3, the Bible says this, let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first. Wow. Anybody paying attention? Anybody see that happening right now in America? I mean, how many of us know people that believe just like we did 15, 20 years ago, and now they're not even church now, right? But the Bible called it. God's not shocked by that. Look at the rest of the verse. It says, in verse 3, it says, and that man of sin, next two words, be revealed, the son of perdition. Who's that? Who's that? The Antichrist. The Antichrist is going to be revealed to the church. So the church has wasted a lot of time through the years trying to do two things. Guess when the rapture is going to happen, and guess who the Antichrist is, instead of paying attention to the signs that say those two things are going to happen and doing something about it. Wow. See, watch this now. A distraction. Stay with me now. So through the last 15, 20 years, it's interesting when you read blogs and get emails, and I have several preachers that are big-time conspiracy theorists, and a lot of the stuff they send me is interesting. It's good. I read a lot of it. And so they'll say, Clinton is the Antichrist, or Bush was the Antichrist, or Obama was the Antichrist, right? Now they're saying Trump might be, right? And there's actually preachers that believe the rapture's going to happen because Trump's last name is, you know, Trump, and the Bible says the trump will sound. Come on, seriously? It can't be President Trump because he doesn't sound, he tweets. Somebody say amen right there, right? So, but people will talk like that. And listen, again, it's like somebody sleepwalking or talking. How many of you know somebody that talks in their sleep? All right? That's always fun. What's more fun is when you engage in a conversation with them while they're sleeping. And you ask them questions and you can learn all things about them in their deep. My wife has seen me signing in my sleep through the years as married. I mean, I'll sign in my sleep. And that can be dangerous to your spouse. Like, boom, boom. I mean, it can be crazy. I think my dad gave my mom a black eye one time by signing in his sleep. And that was fun to try to explain to people, right? I mean, it was an accident. He hit me in my sleep, right? We still wonder, Dad. No, we know the truth. But the point I'm trying to make is this. The devil is a master at trying to get us just distracted from what we really need to be paying attention to. Amen. So tonight the challenge is this. We better pay attention because God's starting to change the decorations. He said, hey, look, pay attention now. I don't know who the Antichrist is. And I don't know exactly when he's going to come. I tell you all the time, he's coming anytime, right? That's the most urgent time you can announce. But I can tell you this, when you look around and pay attention, it could be close. So number one, make sure you stay in a state of observation. As Christians today, observe. Observation is an important thing. Here's what he says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 again, in verse number 1. It says, but of the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I write unto you. Then he says there in verse number four. It says, but ye brethren are not in darkness that the day should overtake you as a thief. You are the children of the light, the children of the day. We are not of the night nor of the darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us what? Next word, what? Watch. Say it again. Watch. Watch what? I'll tell you what he wants. Watch what's going on. Be observant, church. Be observant. Listen to what the politicians say. Listen to what's going on in Israel. Observe. And listen, as Christians today, we should not fret or be discouraged. If anything, we should be burdened about our fellow citizens. But we should also say, wow, are you paying attention? Are you observing what's happening? We're getting close. Yeah. I told you the other day, my brother sent me an article, and it's been verified that scientists can't figure out why the moon is rusting right now. Rust. It reminds me of that old quote. There's only two things that can destroy guns, rust and politicians. But anyway, but the moon is rusting. Rust tends to give a red color to it. Huh, Brother John. Joel, I think, mentioned something about that. All these things are an accident. You pay attention. Read an article like that. Wait a minute. President Trump brought world peace a week and a half ago. How come the media hasn't talked about a whole lot? A peace treaty was signed in Israel. How many of you knew about that? We finally got world peace. Come on, church, pay attention. Amen. Observe. Woo, interesting days we're living. Make sure you keep up observation. Number two, real quickly, be aware of the situation. This is very important. As Christians today, we need to be aware of the situation. Let me tell you one reason why I stay in the know. J. Frank Norris, the preacher, said this. He said there's three things every preacher and Christians need to know especially. Their Bible, their history, and current events. Great advice. This is number one. History is important because if we don't learn from history what happens, we repeat it. And then current events. And the more you study history and the more you pay attention to current events, you say, wow, we've seen this before. I mean, different show, different actors, but same stage. The decline of a great empire, the decline of a great nation is happening right before our eyes. And as an American, as a patriot, I get frustrated by that. But as a Christian, I get encouraged knowing this. God's not surprised. He's not shocked. He's in complete control. And he wants his children to pay attention and observe the situation of our land. Verse 3, it says this, the same chapter. It says, for when they shall say, peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. That ought to burden us, church. Verse 4. By the way, this isn't in Revelation. This isn't in the minor prophets. This is New Testament church dispensation doctrine right here. This is for the church, the Gentile church. Paul's writing to you and me in this passage, and he says there in verse number 5, ye are the children of light. So by observation, you'll be aware of the situation. Number 3, watch this now. Practice consideration. When I think of the word consideration, a lot of times we think of being considerate, being nice to somebody. But consideration in its own root word means to meditate and think. Because when you observe and you're aware of the situation, you then put yourself in a different place as a Christian where you start to say, wait a minute now. We got to do something about this. It's our time right now. I mean, it reminds me of Acts chapter 1 when Jesus had just been crucified and resurrected and shown among hundreds and he's about to ascend to heaven and Peter is restored and revival's going to break out. And Jesus is standing there in front of the people and Jesus is like ready to take a question and answer session. The first question they ask Jesus, you can read it later in Acts chapter 1, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? They still didn't get it. They were so determined to see Jesus set up his kingdom right now so that he was going to set up that watch this now, the kingdom of heaven, which is different than the kingdom of God. You study your Bibles, you learn they're two different things. And by the way, the Jews are still looking forward to that. And by the way, he is going to set up his kingdom there someday. The Bible promises that. But that's the first question they ask Jesus. And Jesus says, hang on a second. Hey, go to Jerusalem. And he says, you're going to receive power after the Holy Ghost come upon you, and then you're going to be witnesses. And 2,000 years later, that's the command we're still supposed to carry. Consideration. Look at verse 7 again. For they that sleep in the night, and then they be drunken, are drunken in the night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love. Boy, I love that. The breastplate of faith is our strength. It's going to protect us. But I love how the Bible again puts the word love in there. But can I tell you something? If we want to reach this world, we better keep loving on them. Amen. Love this world. There's a huge vacuum of love out there. There's a vacancy of love, but you and I can be the difference makers. We can bring genuine God's love to this world. Hey, we know what's coming. We know what's happening. We have been observant. We see the situation. We're now considering it. Now, wait a minute now. We've got something we can do. And then it says a helmet, the hope of salvation. We've been saved by the grace of God. And we can consider these things. Let me give you a couple things to think about, all right? I'm excited about some of the new Sunday school programs we're going to expand upon in the coming months, right? But why would I ask somebody to teach a Sunday school class when they don't even come to, they haven't been to one show me gospel thing, right? I'm not being mean here. I'm not. But why would I want to stand up and teach a class about the Bible when I'm not even willing to go out to the community, right? Those are things I'm considering and observing in the church and out of the church. As a Christian today, we should be challenged when it comes to the subject of consideration of faithfulness. When it comes to the consideration of our Bible life. When it comes to consideration of our prayer life. And our fellowship with our brothers and sisters in Christ. And as Christians today, our consideration has become so self-driven consideration that we miss out on the opportunity to capitalize and do something for our communities. For our families, for our co-workers, for our neighbors. And thank God. I thank God he brought Brother Stone to our church last March. I've been here 22 years, and this is one of the most exciting things that's happened in 22 years is show me gospel. The unity and how it's brought in and to be able to take a John Romans, put it on every community. You know, this church will be able to stand before God in a few months and say, hey, we put the word of God in every house in Jefferson City and Cole County. What a blessing. And if he tarries, we're going to move on to the next county. And we're going to keep on going until he stops us. Why? Because we've observed the situation. And now in consideration, we got to do something about that. You want to teach a Sunday school class? Then get outside too. You want to lead? Get outside too. That's a balance. I don't want this church to ever be a church of nobles. People that sit on the platform but aren't willing to get out on the streets. Help me now. People that have a title but not willing to go out in the streets and or hug a little kid or pick up somebody on a bus or pick up somebody willingly and bring them to church. Stay balanced, church. We live in exciting days now. Don't ever get too good to pick somebody up or love somebody or hug a snotty-nosed kid and make a difference in somebody's life. To pay attention to somebody and listen to them as they speak to you. We've been taught by this selfie generation, this iPad, iPhone generation. It's all about me, myself, and I in church. When you begin to observe the landscape and you consider it and you see the situation, wow, we've got a lot of work to do. And when you throw love in there and faithfulness, great things can happen, church. Have you noticed? Have you noticed My wife is proud of me. I've gotten a lot better about noticing things. If my daughter's got a new hairstyle, I notice it. I work on it. I'll tell you something, man. As Christians today, we better really pay attention to what's going on out here. And brother, I've learned this. This would be a help to all of us. It's helped me. The more I start paying attention out there, the less I focus on myself. Because I keep looking inward all the time. I get depressed, discouraged, frustrated. When I look out there and realize how good I have it. Whew. Brother Helton and I were talking this afternoon after lunch about mission trips we've been on. I tell you what, I wish we could take all of us to Mexico or Ecuador or the Philippines and realize how blessed we are as Americans today. You understand tonight that none of us in this room don't even understand what it means to pray, give us this day our daily bread. My wife shops every Monday night for groceries, and they last us a whole week. So we have to worry about daily bread. It's there. It's in the refrigerator. And if we run out of something, we can 5 minutes drive down the street and pick up something. I mean, do you understand how blessed we are in America? How many know what I'm talking about? You've been to other seas. You know what I'm talking about. How literally a man will wake up in the morning and his number one goal that day is to put food in the mouth of his wife and kids. That's his number one goal. And much of this planet is like that. The last stat I heard once again is this. If you have at least $8 in your bank account and some change somewhere in your car and your purse, you're in the wealthiest 90% on this planet. That's unbelievable. We're blessed. And that leads to number four, and I'm done. When we are in a state of observation, it's like, wow, I'm paying attention, I'm looking around, wow. Then I see the situation, whew, I put some consideration into it. And here's something that keeps us going. You have to have a constant spirit of celebration too. Because God is the master giving us small victories. You see, Christians for far too long have been focusing on the negative side. I'm always amazed when sometimes we come back from soul winning or even the Show Me Gospel, how the first story out of our lips is how someone rejected one. But we don't talk about the other 90 that received it. We've been conditioned by the media to focus on the negative, and we've lost the reason to celebrate. Tonight, church, may I remind you, we have a reason for celebration tonight. We have a reason of anticipation and excitement because back up one more chapter in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse number 16. For the Lord himself shall, not maybe, Brother George, right? There's that word shall you love. Shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. And in verse 18. For some reason doesn't get quoted enough. It says, wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Church, I've got good news. He's coming. He's coming. And then he reminds us in chapter 5, verse number 9. For God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain what? Salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ. That's what we know. We saved tonight. We're already in the good compared to billions of souls on this planet. And when we observe, we see the situation with consideration, we can celebrate the small victory. We can celebrate the fact that we're saved. We can celebrate that God's coming back. You celebrate a little bit and you go back to work. You celebrate a little bit and you go back to work. You celebrate them and you go back to work. Oftentimes, my wife and kids in our travels, after a great week at camp, I'll tell the kids, all right, today's our celebration day. It's Friday. We're traveling back. Pick whatever restaurant we're going to sit down, talk about the blessings of the week, testify, and stuff our faces. It's just something we've done through the years. Why? Because we worked Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. Friday on the way back home, we're going to celebrate a little bit. God's good with that. That's why God gives us those nuggets along our journey, the handfuls on purpose where he says, hey, keep going. You're on the winning side. You might feel defeated. You might feel discouraged, but you're on the right path. Keep it up. You're following the principles that we preached about this morning. You're obeying the word of the Lord. You're striving to be led by the Spirit of God. You're trusting in him for your next step, and you're letting him take care of your family, and all those things happen, and one day passes, and another day passes, and God all of a sudden gives you a huge blessing, and you testify, and you share with your family, and you have a reason to celebrate. And you get excited, but then you realize the rapture hasn't happened yet. I'm still alive. What were you doing, Josh Helton, today? I was walking around holding his throat. I said, what are you doing? He says, I'm taking my pulse. I still got a pulse. I'm still alive. The rapture hasn't happened. I'm not dead yet. Let's go to work. Let's sweat a little bit. Let's praise a little bit. Let's pray a little bit. Let's soul win a little bit. Let's pass out some John and Romans. Then we'll come back and we'll sing and we'll preach and we'll celebrate and we'll praise God and we'll go back out and sweat and we'll come back and celebrate. That's what God wants us to do. Have you noticed? Have you noticed? God's really changed the decorations lately. And if you look, so to speak, on the doorways of heaven, you can almost start to see rapture decoration up there.
Yeah.
It's coming soon. Church, don't sleep through it. Don't let Judas wake us up before he checks us out of here. Church, we got a lot to do. Observe. Be aware of the situation. Consider. And then every once in a while, celebrate. But the Bussy and I have already talked about when the Show Me Gospel Project is over, we plan to have a big party here. I mean, we may have some pie, cake, wine. Just kidding. No, not wine. We're just going to have a big party here. Celebrate. And that's why we want everybody to be a part of it. So we can all celebrate together how this church reached 30,000 households in our county.
Amen.
You know how we know we're going to get there? Because we're at 10,000 right now. And we had a reason to celebrate. But this week, some people are going to assemble them. And Wednesday night, the teams are going to go out again. And next Saturday, we're going to pass them out again. We're going to work. And we're going to come back Sunday and say, hey, now we're at 12,000. Celebrate. All right, let's go back out. And doing that. And God says, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. When we start getting God excited, we have every reason to get excited. So tonight, church, the challenge is this. Have you, I, noticed? Let's be observant. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Thank you. Hello, Pastor Randy Dignan here of Bible Baptist Church in Jefferson City, Missouri. I'm going to take a moment and express to you what our main vision and purpose is of this ministry. You see, much of this world today has a question. It's a question that was asked in John chapter 3 by one person. It's a question that is asked by the masses, but when you really think about it, it's really a question we all have to come to grips with, face-to-face with, one-on-one in our lives, sometime in our life. The question is this, where will I spend eternity? And that question was asked by a religious leader by the name of Nicodemus in John chapter 3. He approached Jesus Christ in the middle of the night and had a question about spiritual matters. Well, good thing for Nicodemus, he came to the right person at the right time because Jesus Christ is the answer in spiritual matters. You see, many of us have questions about that, and man has tried in many of its efforts to answer that question with their own ideas and philosophies. We've tried to come up with ideas on how to get us to heaven, how to confirm our way to heaven. But the fact is, we got to find out what God says about eternal things. And that's why asking Jesus Christ that question is so vital. Because when you ask Jesus a question, you get the answer. And as the question was asked, Jesus answered simply this. Ye must be born again. In John chapter 3, that's what he said to Nicodemus, and that's the same thing he says to you and to me, even today. You see, God is God of this universe, but he's not everybody's father. What does that have to do with John chapter 3? Well, think about this. We all have birthdays. We all are physically born onto this physical planet. Or else you wouldn't be able to watch me, or I wouldn't be able to sign to you right now or talk to you at this time. But God, being a spiritual being, knew that though our bodies are temporal, our spiritual part of us, our spiritual anatomy of us, is an eternal thing. And so God says, I'm more concerned about the spiritual issues. So that's why he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for you and me 2,000 years ago and live again 3 days later so that you and I can have a spiritual birthday and know for sure that heaven is our home. Well, that leads to the next question. Why do we need a spiritual birthday? Well, it's simple. We're all sinners. We've all broken God's law and God's commands. But God loves us so much so that he let Jesus Christ become the substitute for your sin and my sin. So that if we recognize and admit that we are sinners, we can then trust in Jesus Christ as our substitute. And more so than that, our personal Savior. And know that on top of our physical birthdays, we have a spiritual birthday now. In that God becomes our Father. We become his sons, daughters. We become his children. And we know we're going to go to heaven someday. My friend, it's very simple. It's not about what the church says, what I have ideas about, or what you have ideas about. It's finding out what God says directly to you and me. And he did it right there in the Bible, and in particular, John chapter 3, when Jesus says, ye must be born again. If our church can help you with that question, if you have any questions about that, we can give you some answers. We'd be glad to help you in any way we can. Again, Pastor Randy, personally thanking you for watching the message. And again, if there's anything we can do for you, let us know. God bless, and make it a great day.